Good evening everyone, in this video I will show you how I made a little envelope follower. Therefore I will demonstrate what it does on this bass sample. So as you can see, it resembles our envelope quite nicely. It has a little bit of a tag, so you can see it drops down here because this has it release, and then it goes up again because it notices that there was some attack. Then it just stays up there, and at the end it gets a little bit wobbly, and then it goes down to zero again. And we also have a frequency knob with which we can change the behavior a bit so it fits to a specific lowest frequency. So as you've seen probably, the more we turn the frequency up, the more it reacts just in time with the actual envelope of the signal, and on lower frequencies it just starts a little bit later, but therefore it is much cleaner. So this, if you use this envelope follower in your implementation, it's worth it if you kind of have an idea about what's the best frequency to use your effect on. For example, if you want to make a compressor that works really nice on the bass frequencies, then you would set this to 20 Hz and you will get a very clean envelope. Or if you just want to make a very exciting compressor for the high end, then you would set this to 1000 or 2000 or something. I don't get there now. And then this would sound feel very smooth in the frequency. In the envelope, in the way the envelope looks. So let's now talk about how it works. First of all, I will show you the first state of it. So as you see, it's pretty steppy, and you can probably already guess what we are doing here. We just take the sample, we split it into some smaller buffers, and then we get the maximum of it, and then we just say the envelope is the maximum of the current buffer, and that's why we kind of see the wave here, but it's very gritty, and you can also hear the artifacts very loud with all the squares and stuff. But it's the easiest way to do that. And so we have included our envelope HXX, made an envelope follower, set a frequency, initialized the spectral range that is possible from 20 to 120. And then we put the spectral range into our envelope. Then in our process block, we process the parameters, which does not do a lot. Like just when the frequency has changed, then put the new frequency into the envelope, and then we calculate the mid sample of all channels that are currently active, so I don't have to make a difference between stereo and mono. And then we just calculate the envelope from the mid sample, and then we replace the current sample with the envelope. So this is pretty easy. Now let's go back to the actual envelope stuff. We have our namespace here, we have some useful utilities like some functions and stuff, and we have an object called range which can hold a minimum and a maximum, and also have an overloader for the equals operator, so we can just say one range equals another range and it will be cool. Now envelope follower has a size which is defined by the length of the FIFO, and we will write samples into the FIFO And the spectral range, when you set it, then the length of the FIFO will be set to the lowest possible frequency of your range. And as you can see, the utility function frequency to samples just gives you the amount of samples that is needed to make a wave that represents that frequency. And if we go here, then you see that's just the normal function that you also use in oscillators in general. And yeah, very nice and easy. Then we reload the frequency with the lowest range, just in case that it's never going to be changed again. But we actually have the ability to change the reload frequency and use length as a limiting number for that. And then the interesting part is the process function, which just says if the index has reached the limit, then set it back to zero, calculate the max value, maximum, a nice little utility function, of course, not very easy. Not very difficult, of course. Yeah, that's just it. And then we just replace the envelope with maximum, and we also put samples into our buffer constantly. And we return the envelope. So yeah, that's basically it. And now let's get back. Let's go on, with the next kind of envelope follower. Because the next thing I had asked myself was, well, I have these nice little maximum values here now. Can't I draw a linear line between the current envelope and the next maximum? And that's exactly what I did here. I overwrote the set reload frequency method, called the base class's set reload frequency method with the argument, and then made a length inf of 1 divided by length, and we also have an increment factor here, which will be set very soon. So yeah, our index has reached length, it will be set back, we get the maximum just as before, and then we calculate the increment. First of all, we take the distance between the maximum and the current envelope, so we know what's the way that we have to go for. And then we multiply that with length inf to make it a small number that perfectly fits. And then we put samples into the buffer again, just like before, and we, instead of just replacing our envelope with max, we let it go forward by the amount of ink, which can be a positive or negative number, of course, since this is not just the difference, but more like the distance. And then we turn the envelope, and yeah, did I show you already how it sounds? Okay, so now you see it already looks pretty close to what we've seen with the spline interpolation thing, but it's a little bit more edgy sometimes. Now let's listen to it some more. Yeah, as we've seen with in my last video where actually was not the last video, but one of the last videos where I made this wavetable synthesizer and then added spline interpolation to it to make it more interesting. Then the thing about that is it takes a lot of calculations. So if you're cool with this linear envelope, then you should just go for it. And if you want something that is a little bit smoother, then you should go on and watch this video, I guess, or try to come up with it yourself. So we have the envelope follower spline. And what it does, it also reloads the reload frequency and gets an increment value here, and then it processes. Now, whenever the index has reached its length, it's getting set back We get the maximum just like always. But then we do something different. We reset the phase and we tell our spline, which is a spline interpolator object, to write a sample to buffer, which is the maximum. Obviously, you can see the spline interpolator object seems to have some kind of buffer that stores the last values. To be more precise, the last four values, because we will multiply them with this, with these graphs later. And then, so we put the maximum values all in there, which creates even more delay when we have to calculate with that, obviously. But it's okay. So then we reset the phase to zero and we go on with the FIFO, put the stuff into our FIFO, and then we set the envelope to the splines process in relation to the phase, and then we let the phase go on a bit. Usually this would have a range between 0 and 1, but it can go higher, so we have to compensate for that in the spline interpolator. Or we could do that outside too, I guess, but I decided to do it in here, and I will show you now what this does. First of all, you see this has an constructor argument, which is the size of the buffers that store the different graphs. These are the graphs that you've seen here, and they have a size of 1024. Now, as you can see here, so now then we just write down the different functions from this, basically just copying it over, and then the write sample to buffer method. Yeah, as before, we just go on with our index, and then we put the current maximum values into the buffer at the index, and the write index will always be about the most present time, obviously. Now in the process, we have a bunch of index values, and i4 will always be the most present one. So we have it and then instantly at w index, and the other ones are just delayed versions. Then we have to make sure that nothing is going out of range. And then we have to define a value that we will send out later, and it will have to get the weighting of all the different, oh no, these are the weightings of the different buffers, and our index is correlated to the current phase but multiplied with the size of the of these, so we get to the right value. And these weightings are multiplied with the current maximum buffers, so we get a maximum that fits well to our current samples. Yeah, and the clamp method is just a very usual way to make a clamp method, I guess. Then return that. So yeah, that's the reason why the spline interpolator works nicely. Now let's go back and check it out again. So yeah, now you have the ability to make nice, smooth little envelope followers that you can just use to modulate all kinds of stuff, maybe compression or for a filter or whatever you like, I guess. And yeah, I think that's it for today. See you.